Good morning, everyone, and thank you so much for inviting me to speak at Solid Edge University 2013. What I want to do today is to talk about a different type of engineering, something that you may not be used to, which is engineering for the other 90%. About addressing the needs of 5 billion people whose job is to try to stay alive by the end of the day. People like you and me, we need water, sanitation, energy, shelter, transportation, telecommunication, health, and so on and so forth. And what I want to do is to emphasize the role of science and technology and engineering and design in addressing those needs. Those needs are there. The approach is quite different. Here's a quote from Paul Polak. The majority of the world's designers focus on all their efforts on developing products and services exclusively for the richest 10% of the world's customers. Nothing less than a revolution in design is needed to reach the other 90%. I'm talking about 5 billion customers here. I'm not talking about a small number of people on our planet. I'm talking about people who need water, sanitation, energy, shelter, and so on. What can Solid Edge do to address those needs? And we are talking about needs essentially at the local level. We are talking needs at the regional level, and we are talking needs at the international level as well. It's not charity. What I'm talking about, it is not charity. It is essentially, look at the numbers here, the market for joint ventures in the developing world today. $202 billion in healthcare, $424 billion in low-cost housing, $553 billion in energy, $36 trillion in agricultural products and food that need design and engineering, design of technology and designs of solutions. Again, it is not just doing well. It is doing well by doing good, which is a statement of Benjamin Franklin, who came along with that statement about in 1757. He wrote an excellent book called The Way to Wealth that every American should read. And again, it is not a charity model. This is here a unique opportunity to change the planet and a unique opportunity for essentially design and engineering community to change the planet for the better. Now, two approaches to essentially making a lot of money. One approach is a traditional approach for the 10%. Small number of people with large profits, well, you get a big number on the right-hand side, you choose. The other approach, what I'm proposing here for 5 billion customers, is large number of people, small profit, even a larger number. The traditional approach has been this. What I'm trying to convince you is that there's a new approach here, and design has to change, essentially, to address those 5 billion customers. How did I get involved in this project? Well, I'm an engineer. I was involved in large construction. I'm a civil engineer. Design of dams, design of tunnels, large stuff. And for us engineers, bigger the better, right? You don't see too many engineers who write, well, I designed a small dam or I designed a small bridges. So I got involved into essentially a project in Belize in 2001, where I visited a small village. And in that village of 250 Mayan Indians, the middle of nowhere, living on less than $1 a day, I met that little girl. Her job was to carry water from the river to the village. As a result, she could not go to school. They told me, hey, you are a civil engineer, you can do something about it. Design a pumping system to bring the water from the river to the village. I say, no problem, you know. No, first of all, I say, I have a PhD, I cannot do that. So they say, no, we don't care about your PhD, do something about it. So I looked at it and said, yes, I can help. You know, lifting her water 120 feet is no big deal. And as I went back to Boulder, Colorado, I started thinking about, well, where am I going to get my energy at the middle of the jungle? Well, there's no electric plug in the jungle, right? And this is also a community that cannot afford fuel. So how am I going to find the energy? Well, I was lucky that upstream of where that little girl was, there was a waterfall, about 77 feet of waterfall, enough energy, potential energy, to convert into pressure energy. And we use a ram pump and all technology, essentially, that is 200 years old. Nobody had heard about it. And with the students, we designed a ram pump, built it, and brought it to Belize and raised $14,000 and essentially installed that system so we could lift the water. As a result, that little girl could go to school. What I learned here is that the problem was not presented to me from a traditional engineering way. It was not design a pumping system. It was presented to me from a social point of view. It was design something and implement something so that that little girl and 20 other little girls like her can go to school. Different approach, and that was really, for me, the start of Engineers Without Borders. About 10 students came with me to Belize, and that Engineers Without Borders groups in the United States has grown to about now 12,000 members. Half of them are professional engineers, half of them are student engineers. We have about 275 chapters. Some of them are professional chapters, and some of them are student chapters, and working in 48 different countries. So our projects really emphasize design. Our project emphasize implementation. It's not just about technology, because if all problems in the world were technical, we would have solved them by now. Folks, you know that. And it is essentially empowering the students and empowering the engineers to address the needs of those 5 billion people, the other 90% that I mentioned earlier. What I also found out when I came back from Belize is that the students were super excited about this kind of work. I told the students about the project in Belize, and they say, hey, we want to be part of it. All of a sudden, I had 5 students in my class, in my office, 10, 15, 20 students. I usually don't get that excitement when I teach statics or dynamics. So I was somewhat excited to see there was excitement among the students about something. And they told me, hey, we are sick and tired of doing the problems at the end of chapter 5. And I told them, well, I'm sick and tired of grading them. So we had a common interest, essentially, in essentially doing something more meaningful. They mentioned that they wanted more meaningful type of engineering, more meaningful type of design. And it's kind of here the combination of traditional engineering, traditional design, and also social issues that are being addressed, essentially, using software packages like Solid Edge. So what kind of picture are we, what kind of planet are we living in? So I'm trying to convince you that, yes, you know, again, you can make small profits for large profit for a small number of people, but you can also make a small profit with a large number of people and at the same time doing well by doing good. That's a very important, this idea of doing well by doing good. What kind of planet are we living on? Well, these are statistics that I've been able to get from the UN and the World Bank and so on and so forth. Obviously, it's not normal for people to not having clean water. It is not normal for people not having access to sanitation. It is not normal for 29,000 children to die every day for reasons that are purely preventable. It is not normal for 1.3 billion people to not know how to write and read. And it is not normal for 1.2 billion people to not have adequate housing. It's also not normal for a planet like our planet to spend $1.4 trillion a year on military expenditure. You divide that by 365 days, you divide that by 24 hours, you divide that by 60 minutes, you divide that by 60 seconds, and you end up that it is not normal for us to spend $32,000 a second on military expenditure at the same time as we have those numbers. So we are living essentially in a world where we have two different sets of challenges. In a developed world, the challenge is to consume less and more intelligently. Our design has to address essentially issues such as sustainability, and so on and so forth. We need to be respectful of natural and human systems. But in the developing world, the design there is really to address the basic needs that are also good for the environment. How do we keep people alive by the end of the day? How do we bring clean water to 1 billion people on our planet? Think about what it is. I do a lot of work in the developing world. I mean, stay in a village in Africa, and you see, you know, young girls and young women spending countless hours schlepping essentially water, moving, going miles and miles away to get water, getting wood, and so on and so forth. And as a result, they cannot go to school. I've asked myself, what is the role of science and technology? What is the role of design? What is the role of engineering in improving the lives of people? Whose job, again, is to try to stay alive by the end of the day? Think about it. And you have 5 billion, essentially, customers. Two different worlds. And if you look, here's the world at night. Obviously, the world is never at night all at once, just in case you think it is that way. You never know. It is a compounded view of the world at night. But look at the inequalities here on our planet. Well, here, United States, here about 300 million people, Europe about 300 million people. Look at the African continent. How many people live in the African continent? 1 billion people. That's a heck of a market there. How are we going to bring energy to the entire African continent? It's not going to be using a large grid like we are used to in United States or in Europe. It is going to be something completely different. How do we design intermediate solutions so that villages at the middle of the African continent can have access to minimum amount of energy? Without electricity, imagine if I were to turn off all the power here, imagine having no electricity. A little bit of electricity essentially drives economy. People can learn, people can use computers, they can communicate and so on and so forth. A little bit of electricity and a little bit of energy will provide essentially refrigeration so you can keep vaccines and so on and so forth. A little bit of energy can really change the life of the people. How do we design intermediate solutions, not large-scale solutions or small-scale solutions, intermediate solutions that can be essentially, that are scalable over the entire continent of Africa? Your number of customers is 1 billion people in the case of Africa alone, and I'm not also counting the smaller, the minorities, 400 million people in India who do not have access to electricity and so on and so forth. Two pictures showing two different worlds, the world of the poor and the world of the rich. They are somewhat shocking. That's the poor here, is a village, and that's how people live in a small community in northwestern Nepal. They are living under substandard conditions. We can do better than that. You cannot even see the people, and it's an entire family here, but 1.5 million people in the world die because of indoor air pollution. For a few hundred bucks, we can change this situation. Essentially, it's open air cooking there with fumes and so on. You have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 children there in that room, and that woman is likely to be in that room with the children pretty much most of the day because that's what she's doing for cooking. How can we improve the life of that person? So poverty, essentially, when we look at poverty, it's unnecessary pain. And again, for us engineers and scientists, it is a pain that we can relieve. It is pain that essentially we can address by providing solutions that essentially can provide a better livelihood than this kind of situation here. On the other end of the spectrum, you have the rich. This is a picture that I took from the pet spa at Harrods there, and that's how we treat essentially our dogs in the Western world. That's kind of insane too, right? What I want to show you is two pictures, one picture that is insane on one end of the spectrum, and another picture that is insane at the other end of the spectrum. Look at this big fat dog there that is being essentially pampered, essentially. It's not even happy. And imagine how much money that fat dog is being essentially, that person, the owner of the fat dog is essentially spending. But what's just amazing, it's at the Harrods in England there, and it's called the VIPs, the very important pets. How many of you, you know, have access to behavioral counseling, full body massages, and animal Reiki, and nutritional advice, and so on and so forth? Well, when I see something like this, and I work again in many countries around the world there, and I see something like that, it really makes me sick. So there are really two different worlds on our planet with essentially two different types of design, essentially, two different types of solutions as well. For me, when I work in a developing world, it's about creating secure, healthy, and stable communities. When we talk about design and engineering for the other 90%, it is about addressing those communities there that make less than $1 a day, and we try to survive, essentially, by the end of the day. For me, as a professor of civil engineering, my goal is to create a new generation of global engineers for the 21st century. Not just, you know, designers and traditional designers and engineers who can provide technical solutions for the 10% of the world's population, but again, looking at engineers and designers who are called to be change makers. Think about how you can be change makers in the work that you are doing. Think about how you can be peacemakers in the work that you are doing. Think about how you can be social entrepreneurs in the work that you are doing. And think how you can be facilitators of sustainable human development in the work that you are doing. I was talking to several people from Solid Edge this morning, peacemakers. You know, we studied Engineers Without Borders, Israel, and Engineers Without Borders, Palestine. And they are right now working on a joint project that essentially links East Jerusalem to the Dead Sea. It's a wastewater treatment system project where they have to design small-scale wastewater treatment system. Believe me, you bring Israeli engineers with Palestinian engineers in the same room, you bring two groups of nerds there in the same room who really love that kind of work. Imagine using solid edge there and bringing people who are supposed to hate each other, dislike each other, you know, fight against each other, and put them together in the same room and get them to think about solving a joint problem. Whoa! That's a little bit. That's not engineering as usual. It's not design as usual. Can it be done? Of course it can be done. And essentially, I challenged Solid Edge University. I challenged the organization there to promote that kind of work. And also to promote essentially engineering and science and design in a developing world. We're talking about Engineers Without Borders. In many countries in the world, it's borders without engineers, borders without doctors, borders without scientists, borders without nurses, and so on. So it's not only addressing, designing essentially solutions and technology for the poorest people in the world, but it is also training people in country so that they can use software like Solid Edge. They can use their innovation, and they can solve problems that they see in their own backyard. Of course, to do that, you need a computer, and of course, to do that, you need energy. And of course, there you need to be healthy, because you know if you have to have diarrhea every 5 minutes, you cannot sit in front of the computer for too long, and you cannot do a good design. For many people, you know, having an issue of, so it's not when you design, think about all the things that have to happen for you to sit in the front of a computer and express your creativity. It's a privilege that we have here in the Western world. In most countries in the world, in Africa, people don't have that. They have no way of communication. They are not healthy. And yet they want to be creative. They don't have electricity. They don't have power. They don't even have a voice. And yet they want to be creative. How do we bring Solid Edge to the people who cannot afford essentially even to stay alive by the end of the day? So it's not just about technology. It is essentially designing technology, but it's also designing solutions that are extremely strong. So let me show you a bunch of examples of technology. A lot of the work that I do is more in the field of appropriate and sustainable technology, small-scale technology. But it's what we call technology with a human face. I also call it technology with a human heart, because you need to blend the two together. It's a technology that helps protect the environment, that uses local skills and materials, paves the way for a better future for the community. It's affordable, it helps people earn a living, and it meets people's needs. And again, at the center here of my slide, I put a person there. I did not put a ramp up, I did not put a solar system, I put a person. So it is essentially designed with a human face. Solid Edge can be used, it's always used, essentially for designed for human, with a human face, right? But here it's a little bit bigger, it's like 5 billion customers there. We don't make much money. So how do we design solutions? So let me show you. So when we talk engineering and design for the other 90%, it's about delivering solutions that are done right and rightly done. I'm not playing with words here. More often, engineers, we do things right. It has to be done correctly, but also has to be rightly done. It has to be correctly done. It is about the people who are going to use the technology. It is about the impact on the environment. So that's why we need to look at done right and rightly done. It's solutions with a human face and thinking about in your design that people are the real wealth of the nation. It is about people. You are designing things for people, and it is about solutions that are appropriate. Innovation in emerging markets, it is super disruptive. GE, some guy in India, came up with an electrocardiogram that is 800 bucks portable, and he can deliver an EKG anywhere in the world for $1 per patient. Whoa. That's disruptive to GE, because they cannot do that. How many customers does that guy in India have? 5 billion. How many customers does GE have? not 5 billion, certainly much less than that. This kind of concept is called disruptive innovation. In fact, GE came up with that concept of innovation, or frugal innovation. Frugal design, it is about developing essentially solutions that are affordable, accessible, available, sustainable, scalable, and reliable. How can you design things that someone who makes a dollar a day can buy, that is still of good quality, and that will change the life of that person? How can we do that? Yes, we can. How can solid edge software help you in designing things that are affordable, accessible, available, sustainable, scalable, reliable for 5 billion people on our planet? Whoa! That's a heck of a challenge there that we are facing. Why are we always focusing to the 1 or 2 billion people who have everything, like big dog, big fat dog that you have seen in the Harrods there? He or she does not need anything more, right? That dog is better treated than most children on the African continent. Well, let's flip the whole thing around and look at design essentially for that is disruptive and frugal. Here's another example is a Tata Swash there that was developed by Tata. It's a water filter that provides essentially for $22 initial cost, 3,000 liters of water, 200 days for a family of five. Having access to clean water is very critical. Example of technology, here's a telemedicine type of system. That's in northern Peru. 1,000 people live here, the hospital is here, people make less than a dollar a day here, and they need to take an entire day by boat to go to the hospital. The idea here is to put three relay stations and all the technology that goes along with it, essentially so that someone here can talk to the doctor here. That's the whole field of telemedicine. Huge opportunities in the field of telemedicine. Tele-education, the students are here, the teachers are here, the teacher is here. Someone has a problem with the pump or fixing a pump or wants a certain type of design, the designer is here, and so on. So that whole field there is wide open right now in terms of a market there. Again, telemedicine, tele-education, tele-technology, whatever you want to call it. It's more of an intranet than an internet. But here we are in the middle of the jungle in the Amazon River. This is a project in the West Bank there. I was not part of that project, but I visited the project. This is a Bedouin community there in the middle of nowhere, living in tents or living in caves, and they built essentially a wind turbine there. That wind turbine plus the solar system is enough essentially to produce the power, and it completely changed the economy of that community of Bedouins there. Essentially, with the power, they have been able to have refrigeration. With refrigeration, they have been able to essentially store the milk, the cheese, the eggs, and all that stuff, and essentially break away from extreme poverty to still a level of poverty, but much better than they were before. Imagine if today we could come up with some solutions where we take 1 billion people, about 1 billion people on our planet who make less than a dollar a day. 2 billion people on our planet make less than $2 a day, and 5 billion people on our planet make less than $10 a day. Imagine coming up with some solutions so that, imagine that your design and your solutions will allow someone who makes a dollar a day to make $2 a day. You will lift 1 billion people out of poverty pretty much overnight. Can we do it? Of course we can do it. But here's an example of here's solar system. People live in caves, and yet they have access to solar energy. And again, the wind turbine were allowed, essentially the Bedouin community, to really change the local economy. They were not rich overnight, but they broke away from extreme poverty. This is a project that I did in Kabul. I spent 7 years in Kabul, Afghanistan, on and off, using fuel briquettes. The big problem in Kabul is the lack of wood. So how do you stay warm in the winter? It's very cold in the winter time. So I met a gentleman in Kathmandu a year before, and he introduced me to the concept of fuel briquettes, using waste, any organic waste whatsoever. And you make a sludge, and using that sludge, you put it in, you build a press. So we had two presses that were designed, one here and one there. I will explain that in a few minutes. And then you press the sludge and comes out those fuel briquettes. Those fuel briquettes are a good replacement for wood, essentially. They will burn, essentially, and replace wood for families and so on. And the bread was cooked here by a baker using those fuel briquettes instead of wood. Wood comes from Pakistan. And they were able to reduce the cost of the bread by 30%. But essentially what we did, we took 20 children from the streets of Kabul, from the prostitution ring of Kabul, and we took five handicapped, five beggars, and we trained them in making those fuel briquettes. So in the morning they were making fuel briquettes, and in the afternoon they would go to school for 4 hours. But what we did here, two presses were designed. We could certainly do a much better job in designing the press. That press was designed so that that child would not essentially exert too much stress on his body. And this press here was designed so that you can see it's a wheel there, so that someone on a wheelchair could essentially press the sludge and make briquettes. Instead of being a beggar, that person was able now to make $200 essentially a month, and instead of being a prostitute, that child was able to make $50 a month. We were able to scale up the whole thing to about 250 kids, and another NGO in Afghanistan took the project, and last year they made 450,000 fuel briquettes essentially in Bamiyan, outside of Kabul, that they distributed essentially in various villages. But it shows here that design is involved here. But it's not an end in itself. It leads essentially to the bread that is 30% less than it used to be. It leads to creating essentially a future for this child whose job was to essentially sell his body to as a prostitute about 2 years ago, has a better future. It is about this beggar here, this handicapped person who was a beggar literally and now has a job and can be a productive member of society. Design translates into a better future for a lot of people. And that's what the message I want to send you, that design for the other 90% is doing well by doing good, and it really translates into a world that is much better than anybody else that we have seen before. Then it can be, design can be really fancy. This is called the solar suitcase that was developed at Berkeley, that you can drop at the middle of nowhere, but essentially you have all the fundamentals there to open a small clinic at the middle of Africa with the energy that comes out of that system there. Assistive technology, these are pictures that that were taken after the earthquake in Haiti in 2010. I was there in March of 2010 looking at ways of helping there. And these pictures there show that the number of people, there are about 20,000 people, 40,000 people in Haiti who were amputated as a result of the earthquake there. But assistive technology, what's the role of design is in assistive technology? We do marvelous things today for hip replacement, knee replacement, prosthetics, and so on and so forth. None of that stuff is affordable to someone who makes less than $1 a day, or $2 a day, or even $5 a day. So the challenge here is, can we come up with some solutions, technical solutions there, so that we can address the needs of 650 million people with disabilities in the world? Your market here, doing well by doing good, is 520 million people, and 200 million are essentially children. Can we develop prosthetics so that someone who makes a dollar a day can have access to those prosthetics, and those prosthetics don't fall apart the next day? Can we do that? Yes, we can do that. And I think that there are essentially great challenges there to design and engineering, something that you probably never thought about before. And again, my role this morning is to entice essentially some excitement, to make, as you can hear, I have a lot of passion in the work that I do. I mean, I travel pretty much most of the time and work, I work in the developing world, and I see so many essentially issues that can be addressed by design and by engineering. I'm going to finish my presentation with this picture here and this quote of Albert Einstein. Significant problems we face cannot be solved by the same level of thinking that created them. I put three monkeys there on the side because a lot of people don't like to listen to change, they don't want to see change, and they don't want to talk change. Those could be those could be three deans of engineering. I know I can certainly find three of them out there. They could be three traditional engineers. They could be three CEOs. Change is a constant on our planet. What I'm trying to say here is that we need to look at a new mindset. The problems we face cannot be solved with the same mindset that created them. There's no doubt about it. What I wanted to show you in this short presentation is the need to address the needs of 5 billion people on our planet whose job is to try to stay alive by the end of the day. Why focus only on the needs of the richest people on our planet? The poorest of the poor need design and engineering like you and me. Their solutions, it's a great challenge for us engineers and designers. Those solutions have to be available, accessible, affordable, scalable, reliable, and sustainable. So I just wanted to bring that to your attention today. So there's a little switch that is going to take place in your head there. Think about how each one of you can make the world a better place by doing well, by doing good. Each one of us has a gift. Each one of us has a unique gift to give to the world. Each one of us has a unique mission statement. How can you stretch what you are doing best and address the needs of the other 90%? Thank you.